sometimes it's a challenge trying to continue to be little ones and maintain your sanity before you have to get up here and share the word of God. Thank you for your patience. Praise God. Turn with me to John chapter number 12. We've been bouncing around in the book of John. We're looking at some gems, some nuggets of truth. Praying that we can look at the Word of God and be enlightened by it. Amen. There's so much about John that even for me in this Bible study, I've had, you know, it's not the Gospels in Bible school, and then on with Andersonville, looked at the Gospels, but still feel like I'm still learning, and I don't know if sometimes you just, when you're studying, you're studying so much that maybe it's not retained when you're doing it for a class or whatever, but, and even from Bible reading, even to looking at the Word of God, just a lot of good things. As a little bit of a reminder, and then some fresh things, just to give us a background once again about this John who's writing. It was written about 90 to 100 years after the other three Gospels. So John's Gospel certainly is different, and I'll share a few more things about that in a minute. But when we look at it, it was probably that Mark's Gospel was written first. Modern-day scholars say that Matthew and Luke, and they're not sure which one it was, that was written next. But 95% of Mark's Gospel is parallel with Mark and Luke. And we know that all those Gospels together, those three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, were written about 20 to 30 years after the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now that does mean something because they're dealing with a congregation and an audience on a different level than what John is when he comes and he writes his Gospel some 90 to 100 years later. Some was given to the Gentiles, but they're sharing stories about Jesus. But John seems to, more than the stories of what happened in the life events, and we do that ourselves, don't we? We look back and we share stories or life events. Can I share a little story with you quick? Because this is just funny. Around our house, our girls are doing so good. We're proud of them. I'm counting. And so part of counting, we've been counting Sister Stacy and playing hide and seek. And so they like to look for Mommy and Daddy, but Mommy and Daddy also tries to hide them. So Brother Doug, it was Mommy and Brindley's turn to be looking, and so I was hiding Bella. So I decided I would pull the couch out a little bit, Sister Stacy, and she could get behind there, Brother Justin. So I hid her back there, and I tucked some things in around where you couldn't see her. And so Mommy and Brindley comes into the room, and so I said to Brindley, in the living room where Bella's behind the couch, there's some Minnie Mouse chair, little stick chairs and stuff, stuffed animals there. And I said to Brindley, Brindley, do you think Bella's over there hiding behind Minnie Mouse? And out from behind the couch, no! So we're enjoying the journey. But I say all that to say this, that these gospel writers are sharing, as I share a story of my life, they're sharing a story of the life of Christ. And they're sharing it in that 20 to 30 year window. They're giving lots of information. And now John is building upon that because most people have been introduced to Jesus Christ. But he does more than just give stories. He gives spiritual insight into what is happening. So he shares of the feeding of the 5,000, but then he reflects and looks at Jesus being the bread of life, where the other gospel writers didn't. And then he looks not only at Jesus opening blinded eyes, but he deals with the light. He deals with the light that now blinded eyes can see. He refers, Brother Dennis, as Jesus as being the light. And John's gospel is definitely different. The mention of life appears in John's gospel more than any other of the gospel writers. And John's audience, they believed in, he wanted them to not only believe in Jesus Christ, but he wanted them to believe that they can have eternal life through Jesus Christ. And so I love the way that John is giving us a glimpse of Jesus. And as I said before, he doesn't deal with the genealogies of the birth the way that the other gospel writers do. He gets right down into saying that Jesus was from the beginning and that he is the life and he is the light. Once again, John uses that word life more than any of the other gospel writers. Don't you like to think about life? And we're going to be even looking more at this because people think about life. There's a lot of questions when you start living. You know, how do I live? What happens when someone dies? You know, all those things. And John is dealing with that. And we're going to see him dealing with that, particularly this evening. Now, I know that I've dealt with the beginning of John chapter number 12 before various times. I'm not going to deal a lot. I'm just going to look at a few things. But if someone would, so I'm not the only one talking and voice is being heard, could someone read John 12, 1 through 8, and then I'm going to go back and kind of dissect it and give us a little bit of commentary as I've been doing in this study of John.
When Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead, there they made him a supper. And Martha served, but Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound of ointment, a spikenard, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not the ointment sold for 300 pence and give it to the poor? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief, and he had bag, and bare what was put therein. And said Jesus, let her alone, against the day of my burying has she kept this. For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always.
Amen. As I said before, we've looked at this, particularly in other gospel writers. But we're looking, the Bible says, that here it is, 6 days before Passover, Jesus came to Bethany. We know that this is a familiar place, Brother Greg, where he comes, because Brother Justin and his friends live here. He's been here before. We'll talk about that. He's recently been here. Why do you think the Word of God mentions it being 6 days to Passover? What's happening here? What's soon going to happen? His death, absolutely. So he's going to be there with his disciples. And so they don't even recognize it. They don't realize it. But soon Jesus is going to be betrayed. And he's going to be crucified. And then he's going to rise from the dead. But we're looking at, and even Mary and what she's doing is so representative of the death of Christ. The Bible says where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. Now, it's interesting that Jesus didn't necessarily go to the temple, but he went to the house where his friends were. He goes where he is accepted, where he is wanted. The presence of God will always go to the place where it is accepted and wanted and have his liberty to move. Amen. So scriptures even are verifying that even in what it's saying. The Bible says there they made him supper. It was probably the house of Simon the leper. And Mary and Martha and Lazarus was one of them who sat at the table with him. Here it is that they're sitting together, and right at the table was proof of the power of Jesus Christ. What was the proof of the power of Jesus Christ? Lazarus. Lazarus is proof of the power of Jesus Christ. He has resurrected him from the dead. I wonder if we would sit down at a meal, if we would gather around the table, and if we would begin to talk, if there wouldn't be evidence of the power of God. Fellowship is important. And so here they are, they're fellowshipping, sitting down at the table, and they're recognizing this man Lazarus has died, but the resurrection of him, the reality, this really is only about 2 months out. Most Bible scholars call it 2 months out. It's pretty new, pretty fresh. 2 months isn't that long. It wasn't like they had Facebook. There was no social media. So it wasn't like it happened and the next day it's blasted all over social media. Everybody knows. You know, it takes a little bit longer. This is the old method of things. And so the news is still fresh and rehearsed in the ears of individuals. And the Bible says that Mary took a pound of ointment of spikenard, which was very costly. Now, 15 years ago, this amount of spikenard, what it would cost in current money, was about $10,000. And you thought your perfume was expensive, right? But the estimated value of this in 2003 was $10,000. Now, can you understand why, you know, the aroma was magnificent at that price? I mean, this is pure spikenard. This is just, in the alabaster container, it's the spikenard, very full of aroma. And the Bible says it anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped them with her hair. And we're going to move a little bit past that because we've talked about that before. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Really, this is a testimony of what is going to happen in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Then said one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, not Simon the leper who lived in the house, but a different Simon, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? Do you think that's really what Simon, Judas Iscariot's motive was? No. What was his motive? He wanted it for his pocket because he held the bag. He wanted the money. Let me just say something here. I think this is a caution, a white flag, or a flashing light, flag waving to us all, that we must always check our motives. We can cover it with religious, righteous pretense, but is that really, really the root of our motive? Now, I don't know if Judas Iscariot had himself twisted to believe that this was really so, or he knew it was a lie, something that he fabricated, but certainly it wasn't the root of the problem. And so the Bible says that he said, not that he cared for the poor, and this really wasn't his reason, but because he was a thief and he had the bag which bare that which was therein. Do you know, if Judas could have, he would have stole that was being used for the work of God. The enemy wants to steal what is ours to be used for the work of God. Whether it is our time is very valuable. The older I get, the more I realize. Were you ever one of those children that said, I'm bored?
No.
You weren't?
No.
That's good. You want to say, good mom. making sure you were busy, right?
Yes, you did.
And, you know, that I'm bored, you know. There's never time to be bored. So here it is, whether it's our time, whether it's our talents, whether it is the gifts that we can give to God, if we're not careful, the enemy will want to steal them. And he'll cover them up with all types of religious labels. Then said Jesus, "Let her alone." So he gives an approval of what she is doing. She is doing what is right. Don't you want Christ's approval?
Amen.
On everything in your life. Against the day of my burying has she kept this. She has had this for some time. For the poor always you have with you. This is true. But me you have not always. Jesus knew he wasn't going to be with them very much longer. I wonder how often we take advantage of the presence of God. How often do we take advantage of the presence of God? We can make all types of excuses to consume things our own way. But God says, take advantage of the moments you can have with me. Listen, folks, life is fleeting. Life is fleeting. I wish there were so many more who were gathered in with us, worshiping tonight. Because you know what? Really, spending your time anywhere else, but when we can spend that time in the presence of God, it's time wasted. You don't always get these moments. Okay? But to be able to spend them in the presence of God. Let's look on. Verse number 9, the Bible says, "Much people of the Jews therefore knew that he was there." They knew because of Lazarus. "And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had raised from the dead." Here it is, the Bible says that there was a lot of Jews around. They didn't really even come to see Jesus. They wanted to come see this man who was raised from the dead. They heard he was dead. If you see someone raised from the dead, maybe you were at their wake or you were at their viewing, and all of a sudden now 4 days later, you hear that they're alive. Wouldn't you want to come and see for yourself?
Oh, absolutely.
That's what they're here for. They're concerned about seeing Lazarus. It's just interesting that they want to see it. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus to death. Do you know what? These religious leaders, they were mad at Jesus, but they were also mad at Lazarus because he was the evidence of what the power of God could do. Do you know religious evil will always want to kill the work of God? They want to do away with the power of God and the work of God and the evidence of God. The evil religion itself. Religion has always been a problem. We hear in politics, religion always plays a part, doesn't it? We look particularly now at religious diversity. Evil religious always wants to get rid of the good things of God, His miracles. Because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and what? Believed on Jesus. Here they are because of the work that he did in Lazarus' life. They are believing on the power of Jesus Christ. Religious leaders were very upset. And so, all of this lays the groundwork for what we're going to be celebrating in just a couple weeks. Did you ever think that Lazarus played a part in what happens on Palm Sunday? They were upset. They were mad. Lazarus was resurrected. It was the work of God. Religious leaders were mad. They're plotting now against Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, on the next day, much people who were come to the feast or the Passover, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they are hearing about this man who raised Lazarus from the dead. They took branches of palms and went forth to meet him. Here is the one that when they feel like the conqueror is coming, they wave the palm branches. And here comes Jesus. They're waving those palm branches. He is the conqueror. And they cried, Hosanna! What does Hosanna mean? Save us, we pray. Blessed is the King of Israel who comes in the name of the Lord. Now they're looking for a king that is different than Jesus' kingship, Brother Doug. Their ideology is a little bit different. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon, as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, the king comes sitting on an ass's colt. These things understood not his disciples at first. They didn't understand because they did not yet understand the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They did not experience Pentecost and the power of the Holy Ghost that opened the eyes of their understanding to understand Scriptures and understand what Jesus came for. The Bible says, but when Jesus was glorified, it made a difference when they saw Jesus' body was glorified. How about Brother Eli? Amen. Here's this one we just saw crucified on the cross. Here's the one that we just saw laid in the borrowed grave. And now he is resurrected in a glorified body. Then remembered they that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things unto him. The people therefore who was with him when he called Lazarus out of his grave and raised him from the dead, bear record. For this cause the people also met him, for they heard that he had done this miracle. The triumphant entry, man, we're hearing about the miracle. This news of Lazarus, it's playing such a huge part in everything that's happening. From religious leaders being mad, to folks gathering in, being excited about Jesus coming, this work that he's done in Lazarus. The Bible says, the Pharisees therefore said among themselves, perceive ye how you prevail nothing. Behold, the world is gone after him. They were mad. Or when Justin's gone after him. They love him. Look at their excitement. Look at them running to meet him. Look at them waving palm branches. Look at the enthusiasm. Look at the trust and the hope. And they were mad. This is really interesting here. The Bible says, and there were certain Greeks among them who came up to worship at feast, probably Gentiles in this group. The same came therefore to Philip, which was of Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, would we see Jesus? Listen, we want to see Jesus. We want to hear his message. We want to offer his message among our people. The Bible says that Philip came and he tells Andrew, and he comes, Andrew and Philip, to tell Jesus. He gives the information that's passed on from these Greeks. Jesus answered them, saying, the hour is come. He answers the Greeks, he answers his disciples, and he says, the hour is come. I want you to stop and think for a minute. The hour is come. That is magnificent in itself. Because before, and I've said this before, I don't want it to become old hat, before man ever fell in the Garden of Eden, God was faster than the fall. He had already provided a lamb. Genesis chapter number 3, he gives the messianic prophecy. Throughout the Old Testament, prophecies is given of the Messiah. All those spanning hundreds of years. But now, after all that time, the hour is come. God's deliverance has come. The Lamb of God, amen, slain before the foundation of the world. Amen. The sacrifice. The hour is come. Amen. It's about the time for the crucifixion. It's going to pay the price of sin ever since the fall of man in the Garden of Eden. The hour is come. The Son of Man should be glorified. What does this mean? He's going to be crucified, but he's going to be resurrected. Amen. The Son of Man should be glorified. He could not be glorified until they saw his crucifixion and his death, his burial, and then his triumphant resurrection. Then he would be glorified. It's just simple words he's using. The hour has come. But this is the hour. The hour that man has been longing for, that has been prophesied, that the hearts of men and women throughout the ages has been longing for. The Bible says that except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. Jesus was saying that it is imperative that he die. It's necessary. But if I die, but if it die, it brings forth much fruit. The whole reason why Jesus was dying, Sister Stacy, is that he might bring life. They understood that, you know, that one must die, but it'll bring forth many. And so now he's saying to them, I'm going to die, but it's going to bring forth life to many. This is so exciting. Probably every preacher's most passionate thing he can preach on is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that he says, who loves his life shall lose it. I love my Jimmy Swaggart Commentary Bible. It says this. It says the interpretation of this can be translated, he who loves self shall not see fulfillment. He who loves his life shall lose it. If we love ourselves more than anything else, we'll never find fulfillment. Think about that. That's challenging. That's challenging. That definitely goes against the norm. In a time where we can all be busy, and yes, there needs to be self-care. But if our number one goal is self-care more than loving Christ, we will never know fulfillment. And he who hates his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If we lose ourselves in Christ, we will find ourselves in life eternal. Listen, the whole realm of things that's happening is, and there's not much attention. I'm sure that a lot of folks are gathering into the house. They're wanting to talk to Lasher. They want to hear, what is death like? what is death like? We've never talked to someone who died before. Tell us, what is death like? It's interesting. You know, I meet a lot of people through the nature of what I do. So a lot of folks will say to me, you know, I died, but they were able to bring me back. And one of the things that they always say, almost always, is this. People always ask me, did you see a bright light? What was it like?